Amen. I just want to greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. It is indeed a great joy and honor for me to be with you, though I am away from you, but in the spirit and also through this Zoom meeting, we are able to be connected and listen to God's word. I'm really thankful about the life of respected Pastor Sam Kuti Matthew and his family, especially. I don't remember his family, but as Pastor Sam Kuti mentioned, our friendship is from long back, and I still remember that probably he is the graduating batch of 1993. About 27 years back. And I'm sure that at least for the past 20 years, we haven't met each other, but by the grace of God, the other week, Pastor Sangati was able to call me. And after many years, we were able to contact each other, talk each other, and remember some of our old sweet memories. And he asked me to preach today from God's word to the church at Sacramento, California. And I want to greet and appreciate all the members of the Eternal Life Church of God, which is in Sacramento, California. And once again, my special greetings and blessings upon Pastor Sangati Matthew and family. And I want to wish and greet each and every members of the church, all those who are participating and listening to me through this Zoom meeting. Amen. A little small testimony about me is that for the past 42 years, the Lord has been so good to me in his ministry. And I have been able to minister the Lord in different capacities for the past 42 years. And as a family, our family ministry of past 36 years, I serve the Lord with my wife. And my wife is not with me now. She's in New York with my daughter and family. Of course, they are also attending this Zoom meeting and along with you all. And I have three children. My daughter and family, they live in New York, and I have two sons, and they are here in Kerala. All three of them are married. They have their families, and thank God that God has given us four grandchildren, and soon the fifth one is coming. And so we are expecting and praying for that precious gift from the Lord. So I appreciate your prayers. As Pastor Sangati introduced me, I'm doing God's ministry in different capacities with the church ministry, teaching, and also we have some village ministry back in North India, which is in the state of Orissa, for the past 13 years. So this is my very small short testimony to all of you, and I would appreciate and request all of your prayers so that the Lord would bless us as family and use us mightily for the expansion of his kingdom. Amen. And today, of course, I have night time here, and you have your morning time. So this morning, in this worship service, I want to share with you a couple of thoughts from the book of Philippians. And I have four major messages to share with you from all four chapters of Philippians. The book of Philippians, a little brief background about Philippians, book of Philippians, that is, the book of Philippians was written by Apostle Paul, And this church in Philippines was established by Apostle Paul in his second missionary journey. And there are a few things that are very special about the church in Philippi. The most important thing is that the Philippian church is the first church in whole of Europe. All of Europe, it is the first church. And the first convert or the first believer of the Philippian church was Lydia. And the background of establishing the Philippian church or the first members, first converts of the Philippian church is mentioned in Book of Acts chapter 16. And in Book of Acts chapter 16, if you read that whole chapter, you understand Paul and his companions travel, and it was their second missionary journey. And they were looking for, they came to Philippi. Philippi, the city of Philippi or a town of Philippi was the capital city in the whole of Macedonia. Macedonia, the province of Macedonia was ruled by King Philip in those days. King Philip was the father of Alexander the Great. And King Philip was ruling it, and it was a Roman colony in those days, the time of Paul. And King Philip established this town or this city. And the city was called Philippi because it was established by King Philip. So from the name of King Philip, the city was named Philippi. And that is a little background about the city of Philippi. And Paul, in his second missionary journey, they came there and they stayed in Philippi for several weeks. And at the beginning, Paul was looking for a synagogue so that he could go and attend the worship and preach God's word, but he could not find any of the synagogue there. And therefore, Paul and his companions, so they were just walking, and they reached the bank of the river, and they saw that the lady, some woman who were at the bank of the river, and Lydia was a seller of purple, and she was a business woman. And as Paul started preaching from God's word, it was an opener meeting and an opener preaching. And the Spirit of God opened the heart of Lydia, and she listened God's word. And as a result of it, she accepted Jesus as her personal Savior and invited the servants of God to her house. And they went with her to her house, and they stayed there. She took care of them, and she became the first believer in the whole of Europe, and she was the first believer in the church of Philippi. And the second believer was a woman about whom we read in Acts chapter 16, a servant girl who was speaking, soothsaying with the help of evil spirit. She was prophesying about the future of people, so that so her masters get a lot of money because she was inspired by the evil spirit and speaking about the things of the fortunes of the people. And therefore, these people, her masters, were earning money. And one day, Paul rebuked the evil spirit that is within her, and the spirit, evil spirit, left her, and she became a follower of Jesus, and she was the second believer in the church of Philippi. And the third believer is the jailer, the prison in charge of Philippian prison. Paul was very badly, Paul and Silas or his company were very badly beaten because of the healing that took place with the servant girl. And they were dragged through the street. Their bodies were very badly beaten. It was bleeding. And finally, they were put into the prison, and very strict commands were given that they should be kept in the prison carefully, so that the jailer, because of such a strong advice and instruction, the jailer was keeping them very carefully. But that night, something unusual happened in that place. And in the Philippian jail, you know, the whole jail was shaken. There was an unexpected earthquake. There was something that happened which was unexpected, and that those things never happened in the whole history of Philippian jail. And as a result of it, you know, it is God's intervention, and as a result of it, chains from the prisoners fell down, and therefore, and all the doors and gates were opened. And so the jailer thought that all the prisoners ran away or they escaped. And so he wanted to kill himself because he has to give account. So he wanted to kill himself. And Paul told that, no, do not do any harm to you. We are all here. None of us have escaped. Don't worry. So he jumped to the place where Paul and others were standing, asking light. And he jumped there. And finally, as a result of these things, he was asking, the jailer was asking Apostle Paul, what shall I do to be saved? And the answer was, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and your family shall be saved. And the very night they accepted Jesus, and in the very night itself, they took water baptism, the jailer and his family. So the first believer in Philippian church is the woman Lydia, and the second believer is the young woman who was the soothsayer, and then the third believer is the jailer and the family. So this is the beginning of the Philippian church. Paul stayed in Ephesus and also in Philippines for quite a long time, and he established this church. And this was established in AD 51, according to the Bible scholars. But the Epistle of Philippians was written by Apostle Paul when he was in the prison. As a prisoner, he was in the Philippian jail, and that it was about AD 62. And that was the 61-62. That was the time he has written the Epistle of Philippians while he was as a prisoner of Jesus Christ in the Philippian jail. This is the little background about this epistle, which I wanted to tell you. Okay, now, I told you that I have four messages to share with you. Our theme is Christ is all. That is our theme. Christ is all. Or in other words, if you say Christ in Philippians. Christ in Philippians. There are only four chapters in the Epistle of Philippians, and all these four chapters gives us a very special message. How Christ is all for us. Okay, so we start our first point to discuss, and for that I want to bring your attention to chapter 1 verse 21, and the verse says like this: for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul says, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. So our first message is that Christ is my life. Amen. Christ is my life. This is the first message I want to share with you. Amen. How many of us can say this morning, as you listen to God's word, that Christ is my life? Now, Paul uses this term. It's like a business language, a business term. He says that To me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He says about a gain and is a loss. Okay, so what is the gain? Gain is if I die, it is a gain for me. But he says, if I live, that is also glorifying the name of Christ. So my ultimate goal is to live for Christ. For to me, to live is Christ. If I live, I live for Christ. But if I die, I die for Christ. Amen. That is a very strong decision of the man of God. And he says it from the depth of his heart. He says that I do not have any other intention. I am not concerned about any other material things. Nothing is bothering me. Nothing is stopping me. Nothing is pulling me back. If I live, I live for Christ. I live for Christ. Many people say, I heard many people say that I live for my family. I live for my children. I live for my wife. I live for my business. I live for my job. I want to do my job. My job is very important. I live to have my job. So now people have several things to boast and say, and their goal is different. And they say that we live for something else. That is what the whole world says. We see when you look around you, you see people are, you know, they live for several other things. Material things, the things that will perish, the things that will destroy, the things that may harm our spiritual life. And they say that we live for something else. That is my goal. I live, my intention is different. But this man of God, Apostle Paul, he says that to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. If I live, I live for Christ. And if I die, it is not going to be a loss for me. You know, our dear ones, when they die, you know, some of you may have your father, you may not have. I do not have either my father nor my mother. Both my parents have passed away, or they are with the Lord. And, you know, when you, in the human way, when you think our dear ones, their death, their departure is a loss for us. But Paul says that if I die, it is not going to be a loss. It is never going to be a loss. It is a gain for me. It is a gain for me, because all my days I live for Christ. I did not have any other intention. I live for Christ. I am proving Christ in and through my life. And therefore, if I die, that doesn't bother. It is going to be a gain for me. That is what Paul says. Galatians chapter 2 verse 20, the words Paul says is very important. Galatians 2:20, he says that I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Okay, so I'm not living hereafter. I've been crucified with Christ. Amen. Crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. How many of us can say this morning that I am crucified with Christ? In Galatians chapter 2 verse 20, if you read Galatians 2:20 carefully, in English, you know, there are seven times the word I and me is used. I, me, which is connected, our self, I and me. You can count it. I, nevertheless I been crucified, yet not I. Like that, I, me, these words are used seven times in one verse, Galatians 2:20. And Paul says that all myself, my I, my me, that I am boasting, I wanted to crucify it with Christ. and it is crucified with Christ, which means it is nailed on the cross with Christ. My ambition, my intention, my pride, my selfishness, all that I am boasting, all that I am thinking that I am somebody and something, I have something, all these things I have been crucified with Christ. That is the real attitude. Amen. That is what Paul says. To me, to live is Christ. If I live, and that means it is for Christ. If I die, that is a gain for me, because I've been crucified with the Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I'm not living anymore. Christ liveth in me. Christ is living in me. Therefore, I know that my death is not going to be a loss. It is a gain for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Galatians chapter 6 verse 14. Paul says, my boasting is in the cross of Jesus. He says, if I have something to boast, that is in the cross of Jesus. Don't feel bad when I say this, because of my 40 plus Christian life and ministry life experiences, I say all these things. You know, there are many people, so-called Pentecostals, believers, they boast in many other material things. And some people, when they construct a house, such a pretty beautiful house, they say, look at our house, God helped me. They say, God helped me to construct a house. But there is no house like that in all our panchayat, in all the area. Our house is the best. You know, my car is topmost. My job, my salary, my children, their position, their education. People boast in several things. But a man of God who is totally committed his life to serve the Lord, he says that, amen, I boast in the cross of Jesus Christ. In the cross of Jesus Christ, which is for the Romans and the whole world of those days, it was a shame. The cross was a shame for others. The old rugged cross. And you know the old hymn that says, so I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last eyes, I will say. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Yes, I will cherish the old rugged cross. I cherish when I think about the cross of Jesus. Paul says, I boast in the cross of Christ Jesus. So he says, to me, to live is Christ. If I live, I live for Christ only. That's what he says. Just one illustration I want to say. This is an incident that happened connected with the life of Napoleon Bonaparte, the well-known emperor of France, quite years back. You know the history. Napoleon, you heard about him. Napoleon was such a mighty hero, and he has won many battles, very crucial battles. And one of Napoleon's commanders who was leading the wars, one of the wars, he was very badly wounded. Many bullets went into his body, and he was wounded very badly, and he was taken to military hospital. This commander was very dear to Napoleon because of his capability, his power of planning, and he was very enthusiastic in leading the war. So Napoleon was very much fond of this commander. And so Napoleon told that his doctors, the doctors who look after the emperor, they were assigned to saved the life of this commander. And a team of doctors were around this commander in the military hospital, and they were doing all surgery and pulling out all bullets from his body. They pulled out all the bullets that were from his body, and after many hours, the commander slowly opened his eyes. Once he opened, again he became unconscious. Second time he opened, again he became unconscious. This went on for a couple of times, and finally he opened his eyes, and he was trying to say something. He was very weak, very feeble. And so one of the doctors, he bowed down and put his ear very close to the commander's mouth, because the commander wanted to say something. And so the doctor went down with all his with his ears all the way down to the commander's mouth. And the commander was slowly speaking. And he asked a question to the doctor. Doctor, tell me, shall I live again? You tell me, I just want to know whether I live again or not. This was the question he asked. He asked this several times. And so the doctor asked the commander, okay, sir, why you want to live? Why you want to live? You know the answer of the commander? He said, doctor, I want to live. I want to live for many years, and I want to fight for my emperor. I want to fight for my emperor. He can operate, or he can do a surgery and take my heart. He can cut it into several pieces. And if you look into each piece, he can read a name written in my heart. That is the name Napoleon. I want to live. I want to do the battle again, do the wars again. I want to again fight for my emperor and die. Amen. A message that is passing to us. A commander, a soldier who receives a salary from an emperor, if he has that kind of intention to live for his emperor and die for his emperor, how much more you and I need to have. Our master, our great commander, he gave his precious life for us. He became a sacrifice on the cross of Calvary for us. And he gave his life for us. Nobody in the world, no emperor have done it before. But only Jesus, our master, our great commander, has done it. If so, how much more we should have that decision. I want to live for Christ, for to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. So our first message is Christ is my life. Amen. Second message is from chapter 2. And chapter 2, verse 5, that is the second message, second point. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Amen. The mind of Christ, the attitude of Christ, that let that be in you. That is what Paul says. Amen. Amen. Our attitude, our mind, our thought, our imagination, our intention, all has to be connected with the mind and thoughts of Christ. So what is the message that we get from chapter 2, verse 5? And the message is, Christ is my model. Christ is my model. You don't want everybody's attitude. You don't want to follow everybody's mind. You don't want to follow everybody's behavior and character. You put some people as a role model in your life. For some people, their parents are role model. Somebody say, my dad is my role model. My mom is my role model. Yet others say, my teacher is my role model. Other people say, you know, my pastor is my role model. We put several people, you know, the worldly people say about some leaders, some political leaders or somebody who are connected with them. You know, they are their role models. Everybody has somebody who are role model for them. And the question this morning, who is your role model? Who is your role model? Is Christ your model? The attitude of Christ, the mind of Christ need to be in you. And Christ is the absolute role model for each one of us. As Pastor Sanguti introduced me about a Bible teacher, you know, I have been teaching in that Bible college in Kumbanad for about 18 years. Then some other Bible colleges also, even now also, I am teaching in different places, at least partially. Now, you know, many times I heard students, some students say, sometime after a class, sometime you preach in the chapel service, and after that some students come to you in the office. Sir, that message was good. That point you said was good. That was good, sir. Sir, the way you talked, that was good. The class you took, it impressed me. Sir, I want to become like you. You know, I heard many students say like to everybody. I sometimes laugh. And I tell them, yeah, well, it is good. I appreciate it. But I am not your role model. Because I am a human being. I am a human being. You see only a part of me. And there is another part that you haven't seen. Maybe my character. Only God knows my heart. And therefore, you cannot make me as your role model. Your role model is absolutely Jesus Christ. I used to say to such students and brothers. And I want to tell you, dear ones, it is good that you follow somebody, their attitude, their teaching, the things they said, the lifestyle that they are leading. Some parts are good and it is appreciable. You can follow it. But I tell you, ultimately, only Jesus is our model. Jesus is our model. Let this attitude be in you that was in Christ. What is the attitude? The following verses say, I'm not going to read those. You know that. You have your Bibles with you. The following verse. The attitude of humility. The attitude of empty. Being the Son of God. God Himself. Equal with the God in heaven. Left all the glories of heaven. Came down into this wicked world. Lived in this world for 33 and a half years. Lived with the sinners. His company was with all sorts of people in the society. Tax collectors were with him. Adulterous women were following him. Leprosy people, people who have leprosy. And those days, the law of Moses, they say that to keep distance from lepers. He cannot go closer to them. He cannot touch them. Amen. But my Jesus, without any hesitation, he went and touched them, and he healed the lepers. He healed the sick people. He walked with the poor people. He lived with the poor people. There was no place for my Jesus to sleep many a time. Sometimes he slept in the boat, and most of the days, he was in the mountains, whole night in the mountain, praying and spending his time with the Heavenly Father. That was the attitude of Jesus. That is how my Jesus lived in this world. Amen. The mind of Christ. And if you follow the mind of Christ, if you and I follow the attitude of Christ, then we will be able to say that Christ is my model. Christ is my model. Let's put Christ first. He is our model. Amen. Because he has set an example for us to follow. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21 says, Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps. He gave us an example. An example, unquestionable example. Perfect example he gave us. Amen. So he is my role model. One of the greatest invitations of Jesus is in Matthew's Gospel chapter 11. And 11 verse 28 and 29. You need to read sometime later. And the greatest invitation of 11:28 is, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. And verse 29 is connected with 28. You need to read that also, you know, together. And verse 29 says that, take my yoke and follow me. Take my yoke and follow me. And you will learn meekness from me. Amen. Take my yoke and follow me. What for Christ is calling us? He is calling us to take his yoke and follow him. You know the use of yoke. A yoke. Under the yoke, two oxen. One side and other side. Oxen, they will put their neck under this yoke. And that neck will be the belt and tight. And unless the master lift or loose them, they cannot go anywhere. They are tight and close with the yoke of the master. Maybe the whole day time, they are in the field plowing. The master is plowing the field and the oxen are pulling the yoke. They are carrying the yoke and pulling the plow and doing work with the master. But evening time, the master will come and he will loosen that belt or rope and he will take the yoke from their neck and they are free. Dear ones, how long? How long you and I have to carry this yoke? Till the last breath of our life. Till we reach the eternal home, we have to carry this yoke. Amen. So let us say that Christ is my model. I want to follow him by carrying his yoke. And the yoke shows that you are his property. You belong to him. That is why you carry his yoke. So our second message is, Christ is my model. Christ is my model. Amen. Hallelujah. And the third thing I want to tell you is that the third point is chapter 3 verse 14. Chapter 3 verse 14. And the word says that I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul says that I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. My third point or third message for you is that Christ is my God. Christ is my God. Amen. Christ is my life. Christ is my role model. And Christ is my God. I have a God. I have an aim. Amen. Don't you? think that you have a name in your life, in your Christian life. Everybody has a God, whether you are a Christian or you are a non-Christian. Everybody has a God. People who do not have a God in life will never be successful people. They cannot be successful people. If you want to be a successful person, you need to have an aim, a goal in life. Paul says that Christ is my God. Christ is my God. Now, you know, connected with that verse, in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, when we connect, that it gives us a little more explanation about it. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24, following, Paul says that an aim and goal is connecting with an athletic field, a runner in the race, you know. So we are running a race. Apostle Paul is the writer, the only writer who is connecting our Christian life with all these things. Athletical field, as an athlete, and then maybe like a farmer, you know, many other things that he are a soldier. All these teachings are given by Apostle Paul. And here he says that you are an athlete. You are in a field, you are in a race. You have to run the race, not simply running, run the race to win the prize. Amen. Run the race to win the prize. God is to win the prize. And who is your God? Christ is your God. Every runner in the field, in the athletic field, you know, he has a goal, a finishing point. No runner is running the whole day. You know, if it is, whether it is 100 meter race or it is 400 meter race or it is 1,000 meter race or it is marathon, whatever it may be, there is a finishing point. And the finishing point is your goal. That is the goal of the runner. Amen. That's what Paul says. I am also running. I am running. I'm not looking here and there. If I look here and there, I lose my concentration. I want to finish my race. So he is running. And he says that my goal is Christ Jesus. So I am running to reach there. Running my race. Run to win. I am running to win my prize. This is a challenge for us. And that is the third message that chapter 3 of Philippians gives us. What is our God? Who is our God? Are you running your race? Are you running properly? Or are you stopping here and there by seeing this and that, various other things? No, you and I are not supposed to stop the race. We have to run the race. I heard about the, the Olympics of 2005, I think so, which was happened in the Olympics was in Canada. So the 400 meter relay was there, and the Canadian team, and then there are four other teams. Five teams were there for the 400 meter relay, and the Olympics was in Canada, so the Canadian team had much expectation, though the whole Canada and the whole cameras were pointing on the Canadian because they were very brave and very fast runners of those days. And each team, all the four or five teams, they were doing one after another, you know, each person carrying the baton. And with the baton, they are running and passing the baton to the next person and running. So, you know, when the Canada team was running, what happened? You know, the second person, first person ran fast and passed the baton to the second person. He ran fast. And as the second person was passing the baton to the third person, what happened? Nobody knows what and whose fault. Nobody knows. Somehow the baton fell down. The baton fell down. You know? So the person who was running, he returned or turned back, came and picked up the baton. And he ran fast. And finally, the Canada team, even this delay happened, even then the Canada team came first. But you know what happened? The announcement came. The announcement about the winners came. And what was the announcement? The announcement is that we are sorry to announce that the Canadian team is disqualified. The Canadian team is disqualified. Oh, the whole Canada was in tears. It was a shame for the country. A shame upon the runners, the team. Everybody was very much discouraged. The reason is that, you know, dropping the baton is foul. It's not supposed to do that. Dropping the baton is foul. So they were disqualified, disqualified. A message I want to tell you is that the baton of faith that is given to us from the servants of God or forefathers or from others or somebody who led you to faith, who brought you to Christ, the baton of faith, the baton of holiness, the baton of Christian life is handed over to you. You are holding it. You are in the race. You are also running. Be very sure, very careful that you don't drop the baton. Never drop the baton of faith. Never drop the baton of holiness. Never drop the baton of doctrine. Never drop the baton of your Christian life as a whole. Hold on. Hold on and run your race. And that is why Paul's, or the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 12 of Hebrews, verse 2, it says that, looking unto Jesus. First verse is about running the race. And second verse of chapter 12 of Hebrews says, looking unto Jesus, the finisher, the author and finisher of your faith. Looking unto Jesus. Run by looking unto Jesus. That means your aim, your goal is Jesus. Your goal is Jesus. So look unto Jesus and run your race, and you will be a victor, a successful person. You will not be a failure. Amen. So that is the third message that Paul gives. And Paul wrote it in Philippians and in Corinthians and in different places. And finally, he speaks about his personal testimony in 2 Timothy chapter 4. There he says in verse 7, I have fought a good fight. I have run my course. I run the race and I finish my course. Fought a good fight, run the race and finished my course. It was few days only remaining for him to be beheaded by the Roman Emperor. And he knew that in the spirit. And he says that I was running all these days, starting from the gate of Damascus. I started my race. I was running. My goal was Christ. Always my goal was Christ. Never I turned back. My goal was Christ only. And I raced. I finished my race. Finished my course. And now the crown of righteousness is waiting for me. Amen. And my last message, last point to you is for chapter 4 verse 19. Chapter 4 verse 19. Christ is my wealth. Christ is my wealth. Amen. No matter what you have in the world, you may have money, you may have a bank deposit, you may have good business, you have a good job, you may earning good amount of money. Doesn't matter. Do you put your heart in the worldly material wealth, or your heart is in the wealth, the heavenly wealth? Christ is my wealth, my riches. Moses said, I don't want to say any words because my time is almost finishing. You know, Moses, he said that in Hebrews chapter 11, you know, we read that, you know, he was not bothering about the riches of Egypt. Egypt, the riches of Egypt, the privileges of Egypt. Maybe he could become the next Pharaoh there. He could be the most richest man in the then known world. But Moses compared the riches of Egypt, the treasures of Egypt, and the shame or the reproach of the people of God, the reproach of the people of God. And he selected he chose the reproach of the people of God to the suffering of the people of God. So he was not concerned about the wealth of Egypt. I mean, Abraham was not concerned about his riches. He was living in the tents and looking for the city, the unshakable foundation, the city that had an unshakable foundation, the city for which the architect was God himself. And for such a city, Abraham was waiting. He was such a rich man. He could have built a big house, a mansion, even a city he could build. But he was staying or living in the small tent and looking forward for that city yet to come. That is the real wealth perspective. Amen. Moses, Abraham, Jacob, Joseph, all these people, everybody, you know, Apostle Paul and the disciples of Jesus, all of their intention was Christ and Christ only. Their wealth was Christ. Their savings was Christ. Nothing else. They never bothered about anything else. Amen. So they were thinking about the richness through Christ Jesus. Here, my God shall supply all my needs. All my needs according to his riches in glory through Christ Jesus. If you have any problem that you are facing today, any financial difficulties that you are facing today, anything that is bothering you today, any material things that you think that you are lacking, forget about it. Put Christ as your wealth. Christ is your wealth. Heaven is the place where you and I have to reach. And that is our God. Let us reach there. Our wealth is in heaven. Our richness is in heaven. Our treasure is in heaven. Never put our mind and heart in any earthen treasure here which will perish. But let us put our mind and heart in the heavenly riches and wealth. Four messages I passed it to you within this short time. Number one, Christ is my life. Number two, Christ is my role model. Number three, Christ is my God. And finally, Christ is my wealth. Put Christ in it. Put Christ first. Let him be all. So that is our theme. Christ is all. Yes, he is all, nothing else. He is all. He is my everything. He is my all, both great and small. He is my everything because he gave his life for me. Amen. Christ is my all. Thank you so much for listening to me, and I appreciate Pastor Sangutti and family, and also the Eternal Life Church of God, which is in Sacramento. Thank you for joining with me and also inviting me to share God's word. Continue to pray for us. I will also pray for you as church. God bless you. Thank you. Amen.